Welcome back to the sixth part of Debugging at Scale, where the bugs come to die. In this section, we discuss the watch area. The watch is one of the most important areas in the debugging process, yet we don't give it nearly as much attention as we should. In this segment, we'll discuss a few of the powerful things we can do in the watch area and how we can extend it to support some fantastic capabilities. Let's start with mute renderers, which lets us improve the performance of the watch area. Before we discuss that, I'd like to talk about the watch area itself. This is the watch area. In it, we can see most of the visible variables of the current stack frame and their values. We can expand entries within the watch area. Every visible value or expression we have in the watch area is an entry. We can add arbitrary elements to the watch and even embed watch expressions directly into the IDE user interface. Notice the values on the right-hand side. These are typically the results of the toString method. In IntelliJ, we can customize these via renderers, which we will discuss further. But there's more to it, as we'll see later on. For now, just consider this. Every time I step over a line of code in the IDE, needs to collect all the variables in the scope and invoke toString on every one of them. In some cases, even more elaborate code. This is expensive and slow. In the right-click menu, we have the mute renderers option. By checking this option, we can disable that behavior and potentially speed up the step over speed significantly. Once we select that, you will notice that all the values turn to three dots, followed by the word toString. This means the renderers don't fetch the value anymore. They instead show this placeholder. This removes the overhead of the renderers completely and can speed up your step over performance. If we want to see the value, we can click the toString label and the value is extracted dynamically. Notice that this only impacts the objects. Primitives, arrays, etc. are unaffected by this feature. Rendering is the process of drawing the element values in the watch. To get started with renderers, we need to customize them through the right-click menu here. This launches the render customization dialog, which lets us do amazing things in IntelliJ. For the most basic customization, we can toggle and enable multiple features within this dialog. Then press apply to instantly see them in the variable view below. I can see the declared type of the field. We can include fully qualified names for class files. We can see the static field values. We can include hex values for primitives by default, which is a feature I always enable because it's so useful for me. This is an amazing view that's worth exploring and customizing to fit your own preferences, where you can tune the verbosity level in the watch area. But the real power of this dialog is in the second tab, the Java type renderer, which is the next subject. We can go so much further with renderers. You might recall the visit object I've shown before. This is from a standard Spring Boot demo called Pet Clinic. Spring Boot has the concept of a repository, which is an interface that represents a data source. Often a repository is just a table. It can do more, but it has a strong relation to an underlying SQL table, and it helps to think about it in these terms. If you look at the visit repository and pet repository objects in the bottom of the screen, you'll notice that we don't have much to go on. These are just object IDs with no data that's valuable for a person debugging the objects. I didn't expand them, but there's nothing under the variables here either. Let's fix that in the customized data view as we did before. We had a renderer that applies, add a renderer that applies to JPA repository, which is the base interface of this instance. Then we just write the expression to represent the rendering here. This renderer will apply to JPA repository and its sub-interfaces or classes. Next, instead of using the default renderer, I use an expression to indicate what we will show. The JPA repository includes a method called count, which queries the database and counts the number of elements within the database. I simply invoke it. Notice I assume that the current object is the object being rendered. I don't provide an object instance. The ID automatically runs in the context of the object. You can also use this to represent the rendered object. Notice I don't need to cast to JPA repository. This means the expression will be rendered directly in the watch without changing the toString method, which in this case I obviously can't change and usually might not want to. The toString method is useful in production. I wouldn't want expensive code in there. But in the renderer, I can go wild and do things that don't make sense in the repository. Notice the on-demand checkbox. If we check this, the expression will act like a muted renderer by default. You will need to click it to see the value. Let's apply this change to the code, and you'll notice the visit repository instantly changes to use the new expression we defined. We can now immediately see that the repository has four elements, which is pretty cool, right? Notice the pet repository isn't changed. This is because it's a repository too, but it isn't a JPA repository. So far, we did stuff that can theoretically be done by toString methods. It might be hacky, but it's something unique. Let's take this up a notch. The when expanding node option lets us define the behavior when a user expands the entry. The find all method of JPA repository returns all the entities in the repository. This will be invoked when we expand the entry. We can optionally check if there's a reason to show the expand widget. In this case, I use the count method, which would be faster than repeatedly calling find all. Once we apply the change, we can see the elements from the repository listed. You will notice all four elements are here. And since they are objects, we can see all the attributes like any object we see in the watch. This is truly spectacular. And you can't fake it with a two-string call. That was a cool feature, right? But it's so annoying to configure all of that stuff for every project. Here we see the same renderer from before. You'll notice that everything looks exactly the same. The numbering, the list of entities, etc. But when we open the list of renderers, it's blank. There are no renderers. How does this suddenly work without a renderer? What's going on? We use code annotations to represent the renderer. This way you can commit the renderer to the project repository and you don't need to configure individual IDE instances. This is pretty simple. We add a dependency to the JetBrains annotation library into the POM. This is an annotation library. That means the code doesn't change in a significant way. It's just markers. Since it's just hints to the debugger, it's ignored in runtime and doesn't have any impact or overhead. We can add an import to the render, then we scroll down and we added simple render annotation code. Notice that this is pretty much the code I typed in the dialog, but this time it's used in an annotation. This way our entire team can benefit from the improved view of repository objects. If you're building libraries or frameworks, you can integrate this to make the debugging experience easier to your users without impacting the behavior of the toString method or similar semantics. In the next video, we'll discuss threading issues. The reputation is hard to debug isn't always justified. If you have any questions, please use the comment section. Thank you. Don't wanna hold